Penguin Random House Audio presents Red Dress in Black and White by Elliot Ackerman. Read for you by Maggi-Meg Reed. For Vale, Coco, Ethan, and Alexis. Yet the most important element depicts the young woman in the red dress. Unlike the policeman, she is not protected by the usual apparel. She wears no goggles, no face mask, no helmet. Most remarkably, however, her vulnerability in this tense context is further underlined by her body language. She simply just stands there. Gezi Park protests reported in The Guardian, May 28, 2013. Part 1. A Tuesday in late November 2013. That evening, at 9:30. To William, the question of his mother is clear. The question of his father is more complicated, because there is Peter. The night that they meet, William is about 7 years old, and his mother has brought him to one of Peter's exhibits. She hasn't said much to her son, just that she has an American friend, that he takes pictures, and that the two of them are going to see that friend's art, which is very special. That's what she always calls it, his art. His mother doesn't drive, at least not in this city, and in the taxi on the way there, she keeps looking at her wristwatch. It isn't that they are late, but that she's anxious to arrive at the right time, which is not to say right on time. The apartment she's trying to find is off İstiklal Caddesi, which is a sort of Ottoman Grand Rue running through the heart of Istanbul, the place of William's birth, but a home in exile to his mother, who, like her friend Peter, is American. As their cab crawls along Cevdet Paşa Caddesi, the seaside road which handrails the Bosphorus Strait, she stares out the window, her eyes brushed with a bluish cosmetic, blinking slowly, while she absently answers the boys' questions about where they are going and whom they'll meet there. William holds a game called Simon on his lap. It is a palm-sized disc, divided into four colored panels, blue, red, green, yellow, that flashes increasingly complicated patterns, which reflect off the cab's night-darkened windows. The aim is to repeat those patterns. It was a gift from his father, and his father has the high score, which he has instructed William to try to beat. An alley of birch canopies their route, and they skirt the high limestone walls of the Dolmabahçe Palace. Their cab jostles in and out of first gear in the suffocating traffic until they break from the seaside road and switch back into altitudes of linden, oak, and elm-forested hills. When the sun dips behind the hills, the lights come on in the city. Below them, the waters of the Bosphorus, cold and pulling, turn from green-blue to just black. The boat lights, the bridge lights, the black-white contrast of the skyline reflecting off the water would come to remind the boy of Peter and, as his mother termed it, his art. After paying the fare, his mother takes him by the hand, dragging him along as they shoulder through the evening foot traffic trying to find their way. Despite the darkness, eternal day lingers along the İstiklal. Flightless pigeons hobble along the neon-lit boulevard. Chestnuts smolder from the red-painted pushcarts on the street corners. The doughy smell of baked açma and simit hangs in the air. The İstiklal is cobblestone. She has worn heels for the occasion, and when she catches one in the grouting and stumbles into the crowd, she knocks a shopping bag out of another woman's hand. Standing from her knees, William's mother repeatedly apologizes, and a few men reach under her arms to help her up. But her son quickly waves them away and helps his mother up himself. After that, The two of them walk more slowly, and she still holds his arm, but now she isn't dragging her son. And when the boy feels her lose balance once more, he grabs her tightly at the elbow, and with the help of his steady grip, she manages to keep on her feet. They turn down a quiet side street, which, aside from a few shuttered kiosks, has little to recommend it. The apartment building they come to isn't much wider than its door. After they press the buzzer, a window opens several floors above. A man ducks his head into the bracing night and calls down to them in a high-pitched yet forceful voice, like air through a steel pinhole. He then blows them an invisible kiss, launching it off an open palm. William's mother raises her face to that kiss and then blows one back. The street smells bitterly of scents the boy doesn't yet recognize, and it is filled with the halos of fluorescent lamps and suspect patches of wetness on the curbs and even the cinder block walls. The buzzer goes off, and William's mother shoulders open the door. Inside, someone has hammered a plank across the elevator entry. It has been there long enough for the nail heads to rust. They climb up several floors where the brown paint scales from the brick. The empty apartment building meets them with an uproar of scattering rats, and the stairwell smells as bitter as the street. A shuttle of unclasping locks receives his mother's knock at the apartment door, and then the same man who had appeared in the window presses his face to the jamb. His gaze is level with the fastened chain, and his eyes are pretty and spacious, as if hidden, well-apportioned rooms existed within them. The honey-colored light from inside the apartment shines on his skin. His eyebrows are like two black smudges. William notices the plucked bridge between them, and also his rectangular smile with its brilliantly white teeth. The man is uncommonly handsome, and William feels drawn to him, as if he can't quite resolve himself to look away. The chain unlatches, and then half a dozen or so men and broad-shouldered women spill across the apartment's threshold, pressing against William's mother, kissing her on the cheek, welcoming her. When they kiss William on the cheek, the harsh, glancing trace of the men's stubble scrapes against his fresh skin. The women begin a refrain of, "Wonderful to see you, Cat." And while they escort her inside, they keep saying "wonderful" over and over in their guttural voices, as if that superlative is the last word of a spell that will transform them into the people they wish to be. A blue haze of cigarette smoke hugs the ceiling. Tacked to the sitting room wall, next to a white hard hat displayed like a trophy, is a poster advertising this exhibit. It is a portrait Peter shot of one of the women. She was photographed shirtless, from the shoulders up. Her mascara runs down her cheeks. Her lip is split. A small gash zigzags across her forehead, and her wig, a tight bob symmetrical as a rocketeer's helmet, is missing a few tufts of hair. That summer, protests had shaken the city, shutting it down for weeks. Hundreds of thousands had squared off with the authorities. William's dominant memories of those events aren't the television images of riot police clubbing the environmental activists who opposed a new shopping mall at Taksim Square's Gezi Park, 74 acres of neglected lawns with a crosshatch of dusty concrete walkways shaded by dying trees, or even the way so many everyday people surprised themselves by joining the protesters' ranks. But instead, William remembers his father pacing their apartment on his cell phone, unable to drive into the office because of the many blocked streets as he negotiated a construction deal on a different shopping mall across town. By the time the protests had finished, the city's long-persecuted queer community had assumed its vanguard. This caused one columnist, a friend of Peter's, to observe, "Among those who struggled for their rights at the police barricades at Gezi Park, the toughest men were the transgender women." and so Peter had a name for his exhibit. In the poster, battered though she is, his subject's eyes hold a certain scalding defiance, as if she can read the words beneath her. The men of Gezi.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.